And welcome. What is it today? Today's Thursday, the last day of April. So we are excited to give you another awesome presentation. We have Ahpu Labi back again, whom many of you now by this time know and love. Ahpu Labi, are you there? He's on.
Yes, I'm here.
Wonderful. Okay, great. So we want to make sure, first of all, that everybody can hear us. So go ahead and type in the chat. Let us know that you can hear us. Let's see. Yes, Rhonda says yes. Got okay. Yep. Okay. Wonderful. Fantastic. So we are giving you another webinar. It's very strange. It seems like a longer time has passed than normal. I don't know if you feel the same way, but
the days
have been going slower. Anyway. I see. Okay, Anne's here and Jean's here. Wonderful. So I wanted to, again, for anyone who has not been on one of our previous calls, I wanted to go ahead and introduce you to Ahpu Labi, tell you a little bit about how we connected up, and so you kind of know who's talking to you. And then he's, of course, going to be able to tell you a little bit more about himself and his background, and then give you some awesome supply chain tips. So Ahpu Labi, we connected up with him recently via a mutual friend of ours, Norm. I'm sure some of you know Norm Farrar. And Ari and I met Norm, I think, in 2017 when we all spoke on the Amazing Stage and the Amazing Selling Machine, Amazing Summit Stage. And Norm is just very, very, very giving in terms of he's very helpful to people. He's very well known and respected in the Amazon seller space. Big time Amazon sellers themselves go to him for advice. He's been doing this for several decades, and he really, really knows his stuff when it comes to marketing and online and anything having to do with e-commerce. So I've been friends with him for several years now. And we told Norm about So Stocked, our inventory management software that my business partner Dan and I had created. And he loved the software and was immediately like, okay, you guys have to meet Ahpu Labi. This guy is incredible. What he has done, he goes, you know, in all my years that I've been selling e-commerce, that I've been sourcing physical products, I have never been able to see, you know, I have never seen the things done that Ahpu Labi is doing in regards to sourcing. And he was so impressed with Ahpu Labi that he started a business with him, a sourcing and logistics business, because there is so much money to be saved and made on the supply chain end of the business that most Amazon sellers are not taking advantage of. And so that's one of the things that both Norm and Ahpu Labi, and now we have kind of taken it upon ourselves as a mission to get out into the Amazon community and let Amazon sellers know how much they can be saving and how much they can increase their profit and streamline their processes on the inventory management and supply chain aspects of the business. So that's kind of how we came across Ahpu Labi, and then he opened his mouth and we, you know, couldn't shut ours. We were just kind of flabbergasted with all of the things that he was telling us that we should have known for years and years and years. And that's why we have him on as one of our regular webinar presenters. So without further ado, I'm going to let him take the stage and explain a little bit more about this whole idea of how to negotiate with suppliers. All right, Ahpu Labi, over to you.
Hi everyone.
Let's see, can you turn your video on?
Can you see me? I think you have to release from your side.
Let's see.
This happens every time.
Why do they need to make you a co-host when you're already a panelist? It's so strange. Yeah, can you turn on your video now? Oh,
okay.
There we go.
There we go.
Wonderful.
All right. Hi, everyone. How are you?
Hello.
Good, good. Thanks for having me again, Chelsea. I'm really, really grateful. Hi, Ari.
Hi, Matt.
How are you?
Yeah, I was just looking over some of the previous webinars and cutting little clips, like some of the tips that you were giving us in the previous webinars. And it's good to see you again, always.
All right. Thank you. All right, let's get to these. Let me share my screen so that we can, and then I would turn off my video so that you don't have to, you can save bandwidth. Okay, can you still hear me?
Yep.
Awesome. All right, so thank you again, like I said, Chelsea, for having me over here. And let's get with this thing, you know, how to effectively negotiate with suppliers and save some money and also be able to plan our cash flow and everything like that, okay? A little bit about myself. I love negotiating prices. Growing up in Nigeria, and I used to say this in Nigeria, going out with my mom to the market to buy stuff, you have to negotiate and haggle to the point that, you know, they probably will throw rocks at you because you're trying to buy at the lower, you know, below the cost of production. So I love that. I enjoy negotiating. I enjoy, you know, helping people save money. I'm really, really passionate about this. In the past 20 years, I've been, started with Trillion Source and then joined forces with Norman to start ONU Worldwide. Been doing sourcing and logistics, you know, for a lot of years. I've helped launch a lot of several multi-million dollar brands on and off Amazon. I've helped invent a lot of products and help inventors too, and I still do it every day. So, you know, a lot of inventors will come, you know, to us to have, you know, brand new products developed. Sourced, you know, a lot of products, and I bring in a lot of products. So that's why we're able to save on shipping. That's how we're able to save on so many things. And yes, I've made a lot of mistakes as well. You know, I have to learn a lot of hard lessons. But here we are. I'm about to share some of my, you know, experiences and what we do every day, our secret weapons on how we source. And, you know, they're very simple, and some of them may be really funny, but they work. You know, if you can apply it in your business, they really do work. They really do work. Okay. All right. So here is, on, you know, some of ONU's, solutions, you know, product sourcing and repricing. We have a tariff body, which is helping you look at your HTS codes to find you savings, warehouse and fulfillment, freight cost negotiations, and profits finders, soft price checker, inspections and monitoring, and Chinese trademark. Everything we do is geared towards saving you money, helping you negotiate or saving you money. Okay, so, but enough of that, let's just go straight into this thing. I have a lot of things in stock for us today, so I'm going to run through it so that I can give room for you to ask questions at the end. So we want to leave a lot of room because negotiations and negotiating with suppliers is a big topic, and I know a lot of us will have questions about it, so I would allow enough room at the very end so that we can, you know, go through questions, okay? All right, let's go. The goal of this webinar is to help you save money on cost of goods, increase your profit, control your cash flow. You know, when you, money saved is money earned. When you save money, it's as good as cash in your pocket. So that's what we're going to be doing here. We will cover two types of negotiations. We're going to cover price, and we're going to cover trade and payment terms. because, you know, when you're negotiating price, even though you might not be able to negotiate a lower price enough, maybe you might be able to save in the trade terms. For example, if you have a very good trade terms or payment terms with your supplier, you will be able to save on interest rate. Let's say you're using borrowed money or loan to finance your business, and you're able to get a really, really good trade terms or payment terms from your supplier. That will save you a lot. That will save you a lot of money as well. So we're going to go through all the 12 points that I'm going to be touching on today. Would either be saving you money on the price or saving you money on the trade and payment terms, okay? All right. The first one, the lowest price is not always the best price. You always get whatever you pay for. I mean, most of us already know by now that when you go to China, you know, and you're trying to, you know, nickel and dime, and an average Chinese supplier, they'll never say no to your price. You know, they keep saying yes, we can do that. Oh, I only want to pay 20 cents less. They'll be like, okay, all right. But guess what? They know where to get you. They know where to get you. So we have to be careful not to sacrifice quality for price. Your main goal is to get the best quality at the lowest price. You know, this is what I call the best price. Okay? So watch out for a supplier that is saying yes to every price you give them. Every price you name, yeah, they're always saying yes. I would be very careful with that. So the lowest price is not always the best price. And I do have some clients, they're like, you know what, I just want the best quality because I don't want to have to deal with one-star reviews or two-star reviews. So you have to keep this in mind, okay? The lowest price is not always the best price, okay? All right, let's go to the next one. Negotiate like a Chinese. All right, so in dealing with China, I just want to spotlight on China. I know there are, you know, people buy products from different other places, but let's just, you know, do a spotlight on China. You have to really understand the way the mind of a Chinese seller works. You know, negotiation is very cultural. Most Asian suppliers have different tactics and price tiers based on how knowledgeable you are on the products you're about to buy. Their goal is to get as much as possible out of you once they smell you don't know much about your game, about their game. So you have to think and be prepared to negotiate as if a Chinese person is negotiating with a Chinese person. I do have like a very funny China internal price structure. So when you're talking to your sales rep from the factory, these are the things that are going on his or her head. He already has at least six layers of pricing. So the level one or layer one price is just a very naive seller that goes on, you know, a sourcing website. Let's say you go on Alibaba and you type in, oh, I'm a seller from the US or from the UK. I want to buy your product. How much is your product? That person is the person that's going to get the highest price from the supplier. So I call it the how much is your product price. You know, definitely doesn't know much about what he's about to buy, or is very naive on how a Chinese supplier thinks about pricing. The layer two is, after they give you their price, you're like, no, I need a discount. You know? So I call that I need a discount pricing. My son is using the, FaceTime, sorry about that. So when you tell them how much your product is and they give you the price and then you come back and you say, I need a discount, that's they're going to come up with another layer of pricing. Oh, he's one of those, I need a discount buyer. All right, give him like 1%. Tell him we can do 1%. You know, so you you get 1% discount or something, or 0.5%. And then you know, there are some customers, you know, or sellers from the US are like, no, I want 30% off. So they will categorize you as, oh, he's a difficult cheap buyer. You know, he's one of those cheap buyers that always want to beat us in the head with the prices. And then there's another layer. Layer four is very knowledgeable about the market price. So once they start sensing that you're really knowledgeable about a product, then they will be a little careful the way they're going to present the price to you. So the kind of price you're going to get if you belong to that category will be completely different from layer one category, the person that just comes out and say, how much is this product? Okay. And then when you start talking in asking for price in the local currency, then they'll be like, why is he asking, or why is she asking for the price in local currency? Does she know something already that we don't know? So their guards are up. They know that you are an intelligent, or I don't want to use the word intelligent, but you are an informed buyer. And then when you call their bluffs, layer six is they'll be like, oh, I think he has other options. So that's the most dangerous buyer to a Chinese supplier. They don't like the ones that have other options. They don't like the ones that know the currency game, okay? But I'll explain more later. And also, you can write your questions down. We can ask me questions about this later, okay? Let's go number three. Never negotiate prices at the beginning of your sourcing process. That is a no-no. So when you start talking to a supplier, let's say you meet them on a sourcing platform or a website or whatever, many buyers, they make mistakes and start negotiating the price right away. They'll be like, wow, that's $1.50. Okay, how about $1.30? Let's pay $1.40. What about $1.35? Don't do it. Once a supplier sends you his pricing, don't worry, don't say anything. Just move on to the next process, which is the samples. Oh, okay, can I see the samples? Don't fall for the temptation or the urge to start negotiating for discount at the beginning of your conversation. Because why? Your supplier is not yet convinced that you're a serious buyer. So they will have a price already for you until you convince them that you're really a serious buyer. And how do you convince them? You order samples and you pay for the samples, and you sometimes have a courier account that you ship the samples with. So that's instilling some more of confidence in your supplier, to let them know that, oh, wow, this is one of those serious buyers. Or they went to check out your website, or they went to check out your products on Amazon or whatever. They'll know that you're a serious buyer. So do not try to negotiate prices, at the very beginning of your conversation, okay? Let's stay away from it. Try to resist the temptation, okay? All right, number four, project high, then buy low. An average factory in China wants you to give them large orders. Everybody wants large orders. So when you're reaching out to them for the first time, in order to get a better price, you can say, let's say you think you can sell 10,000 pieces in a year, but you only want to start with 500 pieces. It's better you start with that 10,000 when you're talking to them. Oh, we're looking for a price quote. We're gonna be buying like 10,000 pieces. So when they hear 10,000 pieces, they're more excited. They'll be like, oh, that's good. This is good business. The sales rep, remember the sales rep is on commission. So the sales rep will be like, wow, this is good. This is good. You know, they will give you a better price knowing that you'll have a potential of ordering large quantities. But wait till you get your final price before you now tell them, okay, you know what? I like your price, everything is good, but it's our company policy to start with a trial order of 500 pieces. Okay, so that's what I mean by project high, then buy low. Okay, wait till the time you're about to purchase. Wait, do not, you know, do not spoil it. When you're about to order, after you got the price on the 10,000 pieces quote, then come out and say, I want to start with a trial order because I haven't used your company before. I haven't bought anything from you before. I don't know if your quality will be good. I know the sample is good, but what if your production quality isn't good? I need to try. It's our company policy to try with a trial order first, okay? It always works. Some supplier might want to be give you a hard time, but 9 or 8 out of 10 times it always works. Okay, all right. Next one, number 5. You have to be caring and friendly with your sales rep. You see, your sales rep knows the lowest price he or she can sell the products to you. He will not disclose it to you, but he knows because they've already given him or her a rate card. So his boss already told him, you know, this is the lowest you can go, but I want you to start at this price. So even though the lowest price he can give you is $2, he's probably going to start at $275. But if you're very nice and caring, you know, how is your family? Wow, it's nice to meet you. Oh, I hope everything is okay over there, you know, with this COVID-19 thing, you know, are you all right? Is everything fine? Everybody okay? You've got to be very nice and caring and friendly with the sales rep because she or she has the power to have mercy on you based on the pricing, especially if you're just new to sourcing and buying products. You know, she's on commission. The salesperson is on commission, so she might have mercy on you and reduce the kind of commission he wants to make on you, all right? But she can work wonders on your pricing. So be very caring, be very friendly with your sales rep because she knows a lot and she can give you a lot of break in your prices. All right, number 6.
This is really good, Offer Lobby.
Oh, thank you. there's another part that, you know, I don't know if it's applicable, but sometimes when you want to reach out to your sales rep, you just say, hello there, how are you, darling? Is everything okay? Are you good? So that always works because they like to know that, you know, someone cares. Unfortunately, most Chinese bosses that I've seen, they're really not that nice of a people. So when you're dealing with a sales rep and you're very nice, you're extra nice, you care about them, you genuinely care about them, they can do wonders. They can do wonders for you, okay? All right, number 6, defer those minute details or minute details till the end of your negotiations. What this really means is, all right, so let's say you're making a product that is going to have inserts, or it's going to have a special card, or it's going to have a special label, something that you think might cost extra. Do not reveal it at the time of your negotiation or at the time of the beginning of your sourcing process. Keep it till the end. Keep it till the end, because if you tell them at the very beginning, they're going to add the cost. Oh, you want to order a pair of headset and you want to put an insert. Okay, insert will be an extra 20, you know, 15 cents. Oh, you want to have a little, you know, OPP bag or bubble wrap bag. Oh, that's going to be an extra 15 cents or 20 cents. So all those little things, don't mention it yet. Wait till the very end after you get your final price and then throw in those extras, you know? Say something like, oh, by the way, you're going to wrap it in bubble wrap, right? Oh, by the way, you're going to put this insert. Oh, I have some inserts shipping from my, you know, printing press, you know, they're going to ship it to you. Just help me slip it in, in the bag, okay? By doing that, you probably just saved yourself 25 cents to 30 cents per piece, you know, if you threw that in at the very end, okay? All right, let's go to the next one. Number 7, don't fall for the MOQ trap. All right, so when you are just starting out or when you're reaching out to a supplier, they always have an MOQ. And the MOQ means minimum order quantity. Minimum order quantity. So they tell you, oh, our minimum is, you know, 6,000 pieces, you know. Can you pay MOQ price without ordering MOQ? Yes, I do it all the time. Simply tell your supplier you're going to commit to an MOQ, but you need to pick up your shipments as needed, or you can do it as like pay as you go. All right, so let's say I'm selling a cell phone case and my minimum order is 10,000 pieces. And I know that I only need 2,000 pieces to start. So I'll say, hey, wait a minute, I can give you an order for 10,000 pieces, but there's nowhere for me to store it. You know, I might have to, you know, divide my orders into 5 different shipments, and I'll be paying as I'm shipping them out of your location. In most cases, maybe 6, 7, 8 out of 10 times, it always works. Okay, so when they give you an MOQ, don't say anything, just say, okay, all right, no problem. But I like that MOQ, I'm okay with that MOQ, but let me divide it into 3 or 4 or 5 shipments because there's no way for me to store it. And Amazon is gonna charge me so much extra if I have to ship it to Amazon. So I'll just let you know when to make the next one, and then when to make the next one, and then when to make the next batch, and then I can pay for it like that. In most cases, it does work. And that will save you money because you're getting the MOQ price, but you're not ordering the MOQ from the get-go, okay? All right. We're going to do questions, okay? Because I know many people have a lot of questions about this, so I'll allow enough time for us to do questions very soon. Number 8, set up a monthly or bi-weekly payment plan with your supplier. I would say 9 out of 10 Amazon sellers always have cash flow problem. Or maybe let me just call it retailers have cash flow problems because most of our monies are tied into the inventory. And as the inventory is selling, maybe you need money to leave and you pay yourself salary or whatever. So by the time you want to launch a new product, you might not have enough money because your money is already tied into some inventory. So something I've done before and I still do is I go to my supplier and say, hey, you know, Amazon pays me bi-weekly. And how about I be sending you money bi-weekly or monthly? And you just keep making the products and you just keep sending it to me. And I can have like a revolving line of credit. There's a brand that I, you know, that we have something like that for, that we have about $300,000 or $500,000 in line of credit with the factory, because you know they're so used to me ordering all the time, so they're like, oh, that's fine, we'll just keep sending you product. But you've got to be able to do this, you have to be careful how you use this line of credit, because it can backfire, especially if they give you such a large line of credit and you keep buying and keep buying and keep buying, and you know, just because you have the freedom to buy, it comes back to bite you, because you might have so much inventory and not be able to move them, and you're obligated to pay for all those inventory you bought. So you got to use this carefully, please. Don't abuse it. Your supplier is human, so it's just, you know, trying to help you out, and so that you both of you can have good businesses together. So this works well when you have an established good relationship with your supplier and a stable sales velocity. with your product. So if you know that you know that you know that your product will sell 1,000 units a month, so you can use that to budget and tell your supplier, hey, I always sell 1,000 units a month and Amazon pays me bi-weekly, so I might be able to pay you. Every time I get paid, I can always send you X amount. Your supplier will love it because you're keeping his factory busy. His factory keeps running. He likes that, and he's going to work with you. You know, one thing I know about, you know, Chinese factories, that they are very relationship oriented. If you have very good relationship with them, they will take good care of you. So many people come to us and say, hey, I want to change my factory. I want to get this. I want to get another thing. I say, well, we can help you find a backup factory, or we can help you find a new factory or reprice your product. But how is your relationship with your current supplier? What kind of trade terms did he give you? If he's giving you a very, very good trade terms and you're in a very good relationship with him, we always advise to use another strategy to negotiate the price down instead of completely leaving the supplier. Okay, maybe because it's helping you with cash flow. You're getting 0% interest money from your supplier with this kind of payment plan. Okay, so if it's financing your inventory or financing your Amazon business, you should at least, you know, treat him well as well and be good to him, okay? But it's a good thing to set up a payment plan that you can afford, and it will help you stretch your cash a little longer, okay? Number nine, the best time to negotiate pricing is when you're about to place your first order. There is nothing like getting your supplier to the point where you're about to place your first order, and then boom, you hit him with a price break. Your supplier can hardly say no because he has already invested time and effort into making samples and paying his rep, actually. That's what I meant there. I mean, your rep, whoever is your sales rep, the supplier is already paying him or her salary. He's already worked on samples. He's already worked on prototypes. He's already, you know, you already exchanged a lot of emails. And at the very end, you're about to pull the trigger to order. Just tell him, this is the kind of price I want. You know, and how do you play that? The next few slides will show you how to do that. So you're going to see how to play that card very well so that it doesn't backfire on you. All right, let's go to the next slide and I'll explain better. Use the power of repricing to negotiate your price. So I'm coming back to what I talked about item number nine, but let's talk about this first and then I'll wrap it up with the next two items. So using the power of repricing to negotiate your price is another strategy we use to get an existing supplier to come down on his price when we show him an invoice from his competitor. So I still use this about 2 or 3 weeks ago when I just had a client came and says, oh, you know, we want you to help us do this and, you know, help us get our prices down. And I'm like, okay, let's use this strategy. Let's go find another supplier that has the same quality, that makes the same quality of product. Show him the invoice. You can blot out the address or the name of the supplier. Show him the pro forma invoice and let's see what happens. And when we did it, this was 2 weeks old. This is what happens. You see my screen? So the cost of goods was $57,000. The price before repricing was $1.90. And after we revealed the invoice of his competitor to him, he dropped to match that price at $1.35. Total savings of 55 cents a piece. My client picked up $16,500 instantly. That is some nice payday. So, and that's what we did. We got the performer invoice from a competitor and we said, look, I've been buying products from you for a while. You know, there is tariff problems in the US and these. This is a supplier that is willing to go with us and this is their price. And sure, they dropped their price. They dropped it to match it. And another word of caution with this one is you have to make sure you do inspection so they don't flip the quality on you just because you just repriced. So make sure you do inspection before you pick up that product from their factory, okay? All right, next one, 11. Remember I said in number 9, let's go back to number 9 a little bit. We said the best time to negotiate pricing is when you're about to place your order, right? So one of the ways we do that effectively is to set up a bidding war. So similar to repricing is a mechanism I call the bidding war. This is the heart of honest pricing negotiations. We simply set up an internal bidding war among suppliers. When many top suppliers compete for your project, guess who wins in the end? You. So what we do is at the very point of placing the order, we set up a bidding war. And we say, look, this is the price we want to pay. We got prices from other suppliers and yours is almost like the highest, and this is the lowest price. So would you want to match it so that we can send you deposit tomorrow or not? Now, watch how I phrased it. I said, do you want to match the price of this other supplier so that I can send you payment tomorrow? So when I say that, the only thing the supplier hears is I can send payments tomorrow. He's already spent the money. The sales rep is already spending the money. He's already spending the commission on the order. So is at the point whereby it's going to be like, oh, wow. And so just in case he says no, or just in case he says, no, this is the lowest we can go, and then he throws another number at you, what do you do? If he says no, or he throws another number at you, what do you do? That leads us to my fiercest, most dangerous weapon in the history of sourcing. Does anybody wants to guess what it is? What do you think I'll do if the supplier says no to the pricing I propose at the point of placing my order, even though I presented to him another supplier's price and I asked him to match it? I said, look, I'm about to place this order. You gave me a price of $1.15. I got it from another supplier whose sample is also as good as yours for 95 cents. And he says, oh, no. Okay, I can drop my price from $1.15 to $1.13. What do you think? What would you do, or what do you think we should do in that? Just a trick question. Does anybody want to try to type something to see what the solution would be? What would you do? How would you reply? Let me see. How do I check the chat? How do I see the chat? Somebody's typing something in the chat. Let me see. Walk away. That's a nice one. Nice one, Darren. He said, walk away. Someone said, I guess walk out or place a sample order. Oh, we go to the second supplier. Nice one, Sina. I like these answers. But what if you're desperate, you know, you really want to pull that trigger, you love that product? What do you think we should do if you love that product and you really want to pull that trigger, you really want to order it? All right, so let me tell you, this is my biggest weapon by far. This is what you do. Silence. You shut off. Don't reply emails. Don't say anything to them. Just go dark. Completely out of the radar. Fall off the radar. Don't say anything. Don't say anything. So my sourcing team in China, when I was teaching them about all these, they were like, how long should we be silent? I said, for as long as it takes. You know, it worked every time, Daniela. Every time. Every single time. You know what happens? Then they start pounding your email. They said, oh, okay, all right. How about $1.10? Keep silent. Don't say anything. Just keep silent. Let them keep negotiating with themselves. You know, he's negotiating himself down. Okay, what about?
He's doing the work for you.
He's doing the work for you, right?
he's driving himself crazy.
Yeah.
He's driving himself crazy because he's already spending your commissions.
Now he's seeing all of his, you know, all of his time at the movies, his gifts to his kids. He's seeing all that, you know, going mm-hmm. down the window.
It reminds me of that rule in negotiating that, like, when you ask the closing question in a sale, he who speaks first loses the negotiation.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. That's a perfect way to say it, Ari. Perfect. Don't say anything. You'll be tempted. You'll be tempted. Do not bite. Don't. If it takes you 72 hours or 5 days, just go silent. And watch how he's sending emails and going crazy. Don't, if you have a WeChat, don't reply his WeChat. Don't reply his WhatsApp. Don't do nothing. Just go silent until he says, all right, okay. All right, you know, my boss says, let's do it. Then you come back in today and say, okay, all right, I'll send you money. Done. So, Paul, did you get that? Let him come back with the price to agree with your price before you now say, okay, all right, let's do it. Yes, it takes discipline. Because it's so tempting, you will want to fall for that temptation. Do not do it. Just be silent. So we hired this, you know, lady at the China office, and she was like, are you sure it's going to work? I'm Chinese, and I don't know if that's going to work. I said, try it. And then she tried it. And then I woke up one morning and I saw her text. She's like, it works. It works. Now I got my price. I said, yeah, it works. Always. All right. So question and answers.
Scroll up to the top. So we had, actually, before we get into the chat, I'm kind of far from the speaker, so can you hear me, Afolabi?
Yes, I hear you.
Okay, great. I want to get these ones out of the way first because these ones were emailed in ahead of time. Someone could not make it due to time zone issues.
Okay.
But she said if you could ask these questions.
Okay.
So here's the first one, and then we'll get to the chat.
All right.
So the first one is from someone named Lisa. Through email, negotiating for lower MOQ for initial orders. This keeps cropping up for me. I need to better understand the limitations faced by the supplier so that I can address these. On my side, I am often piloting something. I don't want to commit all my beans or all my money until I know something is viable.
So yep.
She kind of wants some feedback. It's not a specific question.
Yep. So there are two ways to do that. So First, it depends on the type of product that Lisa is buying. So if Lisa is buying a product that is openly available in the market, then I would say the first thing is to, if the supplier says, you have to buy my MOQ. If my MOQ is 6,000 pieces, you have to buy 6,000 pieces. I will go on the underground market and go find another supplier that is selling it into the public market at almost a factory price. That's the first thing I'll do. The second thing is let's define MOQ. Why is a supplier wanting us to buy MOQ in the first place? Where did they come out with that number? How did they come up with that? You've got to buy 5,000 pieces because 5,000 pieces is my MOQ. Why are they saying that? The reason why most of them say it is because maybe there is a raw material that has a minimum order. Let's say you're selling leggings, right? And your supplier says, oh, in order for me to make you that yellow leggings, you got to order 300 pieces. But I only need 50 pieces. Why is she telling me to order 300 pieces? It's because maybe the minimum order for the fabric is 300 yards. So in most cases, or it could also be that the packaging, the box that you're going to put the product into has a minimum order of 2,000 pieces. So in most cases, what I do, if the supplier keeps saying no to my MOQ, after I've offered him that I'm going to pick it up in tranches, is I'll tell him, all right, why is your MOQ 2,000? So you might say, well, because the box supplier says I have to order 2,000 boxes. Okay, no problem. How about I buy 2,000 boxes and you keep the boxes with you, but I only want 100 products. So use the first 100 pieces of my box for the first 100 products and let me buy that 100 products and keep the remaining 900 boxes. If the boxes are the issues, okay, let me pay for the packaging or let me pay for the OPP bag or whatever the issue is, let me pay for that so that I know that I can pick up just the number of pieces of the main products that I really want.
That's awesome. And then it gives the supplier the confidence that you're going to keep buying from them.
Exactly. He knows you're coming back.
Cool. Good. Awesome. So next question is talking about getting exclusivity on a design that this person is supplying. So I'm supplying a design to my supplier. And what are the elements or documents that are needed?
Oh yeah, this is something that you do often, right?
Yeah, trying to move away from, like, let's say selling Me Too products.
Yeah.
To more of a custom design.
Yeah, kind of an example is we fixed the design of one of our products and then they just passed it on to the rest of the people who use the product. So it sounds like she's trying to prevent, like, you know, upgrades or, you know, design improvements from then being sold to their other customers.
Awesome. So there are several ways to do that. If it's a big enough order, mm-hmm. you can have the factory sign an agreement because it is your mold. Mm. They cannot use your mold for other parties, but make sure they sign that agreement in both English and Chinese. Mm. That it is my mold, I paid for my mold, you cannot use my mold for any other supplier.
Yeah. Cool. Good.
And also you can, if you've got some money to do battles, you can go as far as copywriting.
Yeah. Awesome.
Just good. Copyright the design, and you can even go as far as doing the patent, just do it in China and make sure you cover your bases.
That's awesome. And then my feedback on that is, like, if you can't do those things, or even if you're still negotiating, but you have improved a product, like, for example, what we did, we didn't actually get any signed documents, but we were the first to market with an upgraded design. And so my advice is just be the first one and push the sales really hard to get your rankings on Amazon. And then once you see that it's viable, then you can go back and get the paperwork signed and exclusivity. Does that make sense? So you've got some skin in the game and you've proven that it's more profitable.
Yep. Victor typed in something. Victor says, engrave your brand name into the mold. That's perfect.
Smart.
Wow, yeah.
Perfect. Yep. Engrave it. Yep. Because it's hard to change that, because once it's engraved, they will have to spend money to be able to do the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. And then the last question on this email, then we'll hit the chat box, is so I'm trying to understand the way she worded it. She says, new products from old. Imagine a company prints canvas for tote bags. I want them to print something different and sew it differently. What are some techniques to help the supplier view this as a good thing rather than an aberration of their product or a variation, going away from what they already do?
Well, I've had a lot of companies reach out to me about trying to explain a product, the way they want the product to be made. I still had one this morning, actually. So what I'll do is, if it is like sewing related, which I'm guessing it is in our case, if it is sewing related, you might have to have it, if you can have it sewn here in the US, the way you want it, just to show the kind of way or the kind of finishing you want it, and send that to the factory and say, this is how I want it. Because sometimes you cannot explain to them, because they have to translate, your words into Chinese and try to understand it. So you can have it all made by yourself, or pay somebody to sew it, or do a digital rendering of how you want it to be done, and then send it over to them. It's going to be worth, if you pay $50 or $75 in DHL, it's well worth it.
Oh, yeah, totally.
We did actually, how we upgraded one of our products is we actually filmed a video. You know, we were trying to explain it in words, they weren't getting it. And we actually said, look at this. This fits on top of this, and then you put this. Instead of that, you do this, and you would just in the video, and he did a diagram, and so that's another way that you can kind of try to get your point.
Yep, that's it. That's how to do it. It's called Chinglish. You have to say it in Chinglish.
And no joke, it was literally like square peg in a round hole. I'm like, it's a square peg in a square hole.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Just change the drill bit to a square drill bit. And
Punch, yeah. Yep.
Next question here. I'm not trying to rush you because we have a bunch of questions.
That's okay. We have time.
From Amit in the chat box. And the question is, how do you identify and confirm if they are a manufacturer or a trading company?
Ah, wow. That's what we call peeling the layers. Because most of these guys that are selling, I mean, Alibaba is a really good platform, so I'm not knocking Alibaba, but looks like some of these brokers or trading companies they know what to put on Alibaba to make them look as if they're the real factory. Mm-hmm. They're gonna put photos, they put this, they put everything, they say I'm verified, I'm this. It just takes peeling the layers, which means you might have to get a harness sourcing agent to help you peel that layer until they finally get to the main factory. And that takes time, unfortunately. It does take time, because when people come to us and say, well, they want to reprice or they want to source product, I say, well, it might take 3 weeks to get it. They were like, wow, but I send inquiries on Alibaba and I get pricing immediately. I'm like, yeah, well, that's why you probably get higher prices. It's because most of these factories, they don't have English-speaking people, honestly. The real, real factories, most of them don't have English-speaking reps or employees. So a guy that is really good in English will go to these factories, take a bunch of few products and go on Alibaba and list himself as the factory. Mm-hmm. So that's what happens most of the time. So you just have to peel the layers. You know, you can reach out to me and, but you know, it could take sometimes up to a month, mm-hmm. you know, finally peel the layer to get to the main factory, because it's several layers of brokers and trading companies before you sometimes get to the real factory.
Yeah. And would it be safe to assume that if your supplier is you know, saying that they're the factory, or you think that they're the factory, but then they say, you know, that they have a product that for you that they'll sell you that they make in plastic, and then there's a different product that they will make for you that's in glass, and another product that they'll make for you that's in silicone, and these are all their quote unquote products. Is it safe to say that they're probably a trading company, because most factories deal in one type of product or one, you know, yes. type of material?
Yes.
Like that's silicone that. Manufacturers and
yep. That's the first litmus test for a fake supplier. If you look at his webs, if you look at his page on Alibaba, and he has a bunch of unrelated products, mm-hmm. you know he's a trading company.
Yep.
If he's selling silicone, and then he's selling wood, and then he's selling utensils, and he's selling metals, hello, no, it's just a trading company.
Yeah.
And some people don't mind that, because they don't want to do the work, or they don't want to pay someone to do the work, so they want pre-sourced items.
Right.
So, yeah. And that's what trading companies do. They already pre-source it for you, but they put up to 40-50% margin on top of it because it's already pre-sourced for you.
Yeah, cool. Which is something, you know, to start out, but then as you work towards scaling your business and launching new products, and, you know, especially as you get to the point of needing to, you know, wanting to consider selling, if you can improve your profit margins, you know, you can grow and scale a lot faster, and your valuation when it comes to selling your company improves that much more. If you're able to then, you know, as your business expands and grows, start to kind of lean down and you know, find the actual factories, or work with actual factories as opposed to trading companies as the next stage in your business.
Yes, and Chelsea, that a lot of dropshippers mm-hmm. do that. So dropshippers will say, you know what, let me just keep buying from AliExpress.
Yeah.
Because I want to prove this product first.
Yeah.
And once they see that it's a big success, then they reach out to someone like me and say, hey, you know, could you find it cheaper, because I'm buying it on AliExpress, and whatever price you see on AliExpress is almost a guarantee. It has 40-60% margin on it.
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay, yeah. Good. Next question is from Darren. And the question is, what platforms are best to use for communications and negotiations? Alibaba, email, etc.
Honestly, I use WeChat.
Okay.
I don't know if they have WeChat. If he has WeChat, it's faster on WeChat, because, you know, you keep communicating and it's immediately.
Yeah.
You know, as long as you wake up at the right time, they're all, or if it's a factory that has a rep that works, you know, in US time zones. But WeChat, I found WeChat to be the most effective in communicating.
Okay. Is that similar to like ManyChat?
Yeah, it's
I have WeChat.
I think WeChat's the one where it's a Chinese-based app, so sometimes you have to get permission to be invited or something.
Yeah.
Yes.
We were in China, and we tried to set it up while in China. I would say if you're going to set it up, don't set it up while you're in China. Set it up in the U.S., because we tried to set it up while we were in China, and we got, like, blocked. So I don't know. I don't know what that was about.
They probably didn't like my Facebook posts or something.
Yeah, they censor everything. Once they see your IP, they know you're roaming it from the US, and they will censor that.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that's good advice. Okay. The next question is from Daniela. If finding a supplier through a sourcing agent, how can we keep going the relationship with the non-English speaking supplier? So, like, keep building the relationship. there may always be different aspects which need clarification for every order.
Well, if you find a supplier through a sourcing agent, how can you keep going with the relationship with the non-English speaking supplier?
I get it. Like, in other words, do you have to keep using your sourcing agent?
Oh, well, if the supplier doesn't speak English, then you might be better to keep using your sourcing agent. The only problem is that most sourcing agent will not transfer the savings to you. They might decide they want to make as much as 30% or whatever. So that's the only downside there. But I wouldn't advise you to try to communicate with your non-English supplier all by yourself, unless you're not going to be changing anything in your product. It's just reorder. If you're just reordering, then it's easier. You know, you could find a way to reorder, or
Google Translate. I mean, it's the same order as last time.
Yeah, or you can have order processing. You know, like you know, we can set something up for you that you, if you're just order processing, I can just have one of my staff in China just help you process orders.
Right.
You know, that's easy. If it doesn't require you talking and having a conversation with your supplier, we can just do like an order processing liaison or something. That it's your supplier, you already know the price, we're just helping you communicate to do your orders, then that can be.
Yeah, because regardless if you go through a trading company or a sourcing agent or direct to a non-English speaking manufacturer and you only speak English, you're going to have to pay somebody to translate.
Yeah. So it's who would.
That's the void.
Who do you trust versus? Because for me, it's not just saving the most money. I want to work with a person who I trust, who gets back to me quickly.
Yeah.
Who is professional. You know, I don't send an email and wait 3 days for an answer. Like, those are at least as important, if not more important, mm-hmm. as saving money. Yeah. In my opinion. So, did we lose Akalabi?
Uh-oh. Looks like he's still here.
Okay. Can you hear us, Akalabi?
Hmm.
Webinar still
going?
Let
me text him.
Okay. All right. Oh, I got kicked out.
Oh, I got lost.
Oh, there we go.
I got kicked out.
Okay, so. He's back.
You got kicked out too?
Yeah.
No, I didn't. The screen's not sharing.
Oh, no, it's just because he was sharing the screen and now he's not.
Oh, okay,
so.
Cool.
Oh, okay. Okay.
The visuals,
Video, that's what I'm trying to say.
Okay.
In the meantime, so.
I'm trying to.
I'll go to the next question here. So, another one from Amit. If the point of contact, sales rep in the company, moves to another company or factory and offers a better price, should I trust him or her with a new company or stick with the original company and deal with a new sales rep? That's a great question.
That's a good one. That's a good one. That's really good. Well, that's a nice one.
Yeah, there's good questions at you today.
First, I would like to know why that sales guy left that company.
Ooh, yes.
Because that means that same person can take your trade secrets and take it to another company.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. Isn't that what it means? That means if he, because there are some sales rep that go from company to company and they take the sales secret, they take the trade secret with them.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll be openly welcomed by the new boss because they know he's coming with a trade secret.
Yeah.
So that means I will be really, 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 really afraid of dealing with him, you know, because, you know, I don't know, it's not so ethical what he's doing. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if he would not mess me up eventually, mm. you know, and try to sell my products to other people even.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. So, I mean, it's kind of one of those it depends questions.
You know? Yes, yes. But
figure out more information.
Depends on the circumstances he left the company for. Mm.
Cool. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's all the questions we have, so.
Okay, good. So I'm currently screen sharing. So we did want to share with you, there's something that you have been very gracious. And you, Alpha Lobby actually texted us today. Let me share my video so people can kind of see me. Stop screen sharing. All right. Alpha Lobby, you want to turn your video back on?
Oh, okay.
Yeah. All right, so it looks like that's all of the questions. Really, really good questions. Oh, wait, there's one more question. Did you do this one? Stick to the original? Oh, no, we already did that one. Okay, okay, perfect. So one of the things that happened, so Alpha Lobby has a company. I mentioned at the beginning of this that he has a company with Norm called Hanu. And so one of the things that was really interesting is he loves to find deals, and he loves to help people to improve their businesses. And he was very gracious. He has a specific service that he provides that he was actually wanted to offer a special for only who was on the call today. Texted me this morning. Where is my screen share? Okay, and I'm going to share a little bit about that. And you can obviously jump in and share anything else about that as well. But he has something called the Profit Finder, right, or the Savings Finder. And this is for only the people on this webinar. This is not something that he offers at this specific reduced rate. Essentially, one of the things that he does is he'll look at, he calls it, it's like a business audit. Because, you know, if you'll look, he looks at all of your purchase orders, looks at all of your invoices, and is able to find typically up to 10% savings in most businesses. So if you were to take the amount that you're paying on a monthly or annual basis and to knock 10% off of that, like just consider what that savings would be to you. I know that, you know, for most people it's thousands, if not tens of thousands of dollars. And so he looks at sourcing, and these sourcing techniques and these negotiation techniques are what he's then able to kind of he'll know what pricing to offer or what pricing he can get. I'm sure, you know, if he were to look at, you know, some of our purchase orders, he would laugh. And then looks at shipping. If you've seen his last 2 weeks ago, he did one on shipping hacks and, you know, the ways to get the reduced shipping prices. He's been doing this for 20 years. And then the other thing that we kind of, you know, wanted to throw in was this access to SoStock, right? SoStock is our inventory management system. It's how we met Alpha Lobby. And inventory management, you know, is extremely important in terms of, you know, when you're not keeping in stock, you're losing a lot in terms of money, in terms of storage fees, in terms of, you know, air shipping. And so that's, you know, kind of what his program and our SoStock combined work to help you to get streamlined. So essentially you're overpaying your suppliers. One, if you contacted them through Alibaba or another sourcing website, if you're talking to them in a language other than Chinese, and if you're paying for paying them in something other than Chinese currency, right? These are some of the things that Alpha Lobby helps with. And helps to get your pricing down. So if you know that you're paying too much for your supply or paying too much for your shipping, but just don't know how to go about finding, you know, ways to do that, that's what he does, right? So if you've got a quote off of an online shipping platform, if you didn't get multiple shipping quotes, or if you didn't negotiate your shipping rates, you're probably paying too much to your freight forwarder.
Yep.
And I mean, I know that it's been, you know, it's one of those things that we've known for years that we are paying too much, but we don't know how to do, you know, we haven't known how to reduce the prices, you know. We have a friend who, you know, has been going to China for 20 years or something like that. and was talking to us and a friend of ours, and our friend is very confident in her negotiating skills, and she's like, oh yeah, I'm, you know, was bragging about how well she negotiated, and he goes, you know, you think that you have hit the basement on a price, and I go 10 levels deep. And I was just like, I want to know how to do that. And so that's what Rafa Lobby does. He goes, you think you hit the basement of the, in terms of, you know, your supply chain prices, he's going 10 levels deep. So that's, you know, kind of what he offers. He'll be able to kind of look at your stuff and show you how to save money. It's kind of a business audit on the supply chain aspect. We all know, we take all those, you know, the courses and the webinars and the training on how to increase our sales, how to increase our traffic, how to increase our conversion, how to pick a winning product. We don't often look at this side of our business. And that's something that we're trying to bring to the forefront, is that Amazon sellers really need to look at this side of their business as the place that they're leaving the most money on the table, right? Like Abu Labi said, you can't just, what is it that you say? You can't just make money when you sell, you have to make money when you buy.
You buy, yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
So this is a Profit Finder. The Profit Finder, it will be, it's $995 to look at your entire business, right? And that's only available for the next 24 hours. However, he texted myself and my business partner this morning and said, why don't we knock that down? Why don't we knock that price down? So for the next hour, we're doing it for $695, and this is to look at your entire business, to give you a strategy on, you know, what to do, what products you should be, you know, sourcing differently, how you should be differently handling your shipping, all for $695. So, I mean, I think that's extremely valuable. You get his, you know, one-on-one view of, you know, he and his savings experts look at your business specifically. And so that's at sostocked.com /savings-finder.
And Victor says it's a really good deal. So you have Victor's endorsement.
Yeah, that's to be able to look at and find, you know, potentially find thousands or tens of thousands of dollars in savings.
Yeah.
It's, you know, if you could have Tofu Lobby help you to restructure your entire supply chain for $695, I mean, that's, you know, that's amazing.
Yep.
And here's the other amazing thing, guys. It's savings guaranteed or your money back, which I thought was crazy. And I actually, when we were discussing this, I had to ask multiple times, are you sure? Like, you know, are you really want to do that? And he said, you know, I have not looked at a business and not found savings. So that's why he feels so confident in being able to offer, you know, money back. You know, and we asked that, you know, when we were talking to him about our own business. Well, what if you can't find me what if you can't find me anything that, you know, savings on, you know, the product? What if I'm getting the lowest price? He's like, well, then, you know, I will give you your money back. So, but that never happens, he says. And I'd rather pay $695 and save thousands of dollars and, you know, get $695 back because it didn't work. So anyway, again, that's sostocked.com /savings-finder.
There's a link in the chat.
There's a link in the chat.
So I believe you have to put www. It doesn't work.
Yeah, not lifetime saving, not lifetime offer.
It's the second too.
Yeah. Anyway, it's, yeah. And Afu Lobby, we're going to be talking soon because we have, you know, it's interesting, like right now, guys, if you have any products that started moving, we had some products that started moving that weren't moving before. And right now we're like, we need to resource these because we could be making a lot more money on it because we know we're paying too much. We know we're paying too much for some of our products. So we're going to be
working. It's going to be a little embarrassing once you look
into it. No, but it's going to be great because then we can get on here and say, guys, look what we saved. Like, you know. So that's for the next hour only. The 48 hours is, so basically for the next hour, it's $695, and then the price jumps up to $995, and that's for 48 hours only, and then the page will disappear. And that also includes 3 free months of SoStocked, including us doing an online call with myself or one of my business partners to actually help you to structure and onboard yourself into the software. so that you can keep track of your inventory so you don't continue to run out. Because that, you know, Afolabi was saying that, you know, he basically, when he found out SoStock, he went and got a bunch of his clients into it because he was so tired of them running out of inventory. So that, you know, it's like you can save all this money, but then if you have to air freight or you have to, you know, pay all this sponsored ads cost for re-ranking, then, you know, what's the point? So
yeah, it's not worth it. Not worth it. Yeah,
exactly. So, yeah. Yeah, so the last thing is our webinar series is continuing. We have several webinars coming up with Afolabi, which you can find at sostock.com/seller-secrets. And then next week, I am doing my inventory planning in a pandemic talk, talking about the things that you need to know for how to structure and plan your 2020 based on the weird stuff happening with Amazon, with lead times, with you know, changes to your sales velocities. And that's sostock.com/inventory-secrets. All right, let's stop this sharing. All right, so any other questions we have? Anything like that? Doesn't look like it. Okay, well, thank you guys so much for attending. Thanks, Afolabi, so much. This is just every time we got on, I'm like, why didn't we hear about all this from you 5 years ago?
Thank you, everyone. I really enjoyed myself. Looking forward to the next one.